好，接下去的这一位呢 ，Previews of a new prosthetic arm， 它是什么意思？他这一位是一个发明家，也是一个设计家。他做了一件事情，这件事情也是我很佩服。我认为这个是非常难、非常难的一件事情，也是一种叫做不可能挑战的事情。他去挑战了。那么给他任务的是谁呢？是美国政府。美国政府为什么要给他这个任务呢？是因为美国过去的很多年在全世界各地打仗，他回来有非常多的伤兵，那些伤兵呢，不是没有手就是没有脚，最更重要就是说他手受伤，他怎么样子能够让他重新变成面对这样子的一个困境。先介绍一下他，他是一个在大学的时候没有读完就离开大学的人，不过他是一个 huge 很大的 believer in education， 他相信教育。他虽然离开大学，可是他相信教育。在1989年，他这个创立了一个 non-profit， 一个非营利组织，叫做 FIRST。这个 FIRST 就是 for inspiration and recognition of science and technology， 就是要启发跟这个认证这个对于科学跟科技这个很不错的年轻人，他想要去把这个十几岁的小孩去让他们去。愿意在科学里面发展他们的前途，所以这个 FIRST 这个组织是他去创造的。那每一年都有一些比赛，所以各位如果有兴趣也可以去网络上看看。我们先来看看他的这个影片，是说他做了什么事情。
I got a visit just almost exactly a year ago, a little over a year ago, from a very senior person at the Department of Defense. Came to see me and said, 1,600 of the kids that we've sent out have come back missing at least one full arm. Whole arm, shoulder dysarthric. And we're doing the same thing we did for more or less that we've done since the Civil War, a stick and a hook. And they deserve more than that.And literally, this guy sat in my office in New Hampshire and said, I want you to give me something that we can put on these kids that'll pick up a raisin or a grape off a table. They'll be able to put it in their mouth without destroying either one. And they'll be able to know the difference without looking at it. You know, add efferent, afferent, and haptic response. He finishes explaining that, and I'm waiting for the big 300-pound paper proposal, and he said, that's what I want from you. I said, look, you're nuts. That technology is just not available right now, and it can't be done. Not in an envelope of a human arm with 21 degrees of freedom from your shoulder to your fingertips. He said, about 24 of these 1,600 kids have come back bilateral.You think it's bad to lose one arm? That's an inconvenience compared to having both of them gone. I got a day job, and my nights and weekends are already filled up with things like, let's supply water to the world and power to the world and educate all the kids, which, Chris, I will not talk about. I don't need another mission. I keep thinking about these kids with no arms.He says to me, we've done some work around the country. We've got some pretty amazing neurology and other people. I said, I'll take a field trip. I'll go see what you got. Over the next month, I visited lots of places, some out here around the country, found the best of the best. I went down to Washington. I saw these guys and said, I did what you asked me. I looked at what's out there. I still think you're nuts, but not as nuts as I thought. I put a team together a little over 13 months ago, it got up to 20 some odd people. We said, we're going to build a device that does what he wants. We have 14 out of the 21 degrees of freedom. You don't need the ones in the last two fingers. We put this thing together. A couple of weeks ago, we took it down to Walter Reed, which is unfortunately more in the news these days. We showed it to a bunch of guys. One guy who described himself as being lucky because he lost his left arm and he's a righty. He sat at a table with seven or eight of these other guys, said he was lucky because he had his good arm, and then he pushed himself back from the table. He had no legs. These kids have attitudes that you just can't believe. So I'm going to show you now without the skin on it, a 30-second piece, and then I'm done. But understand what you're looking at. We made small enough to fit on a 50th percentile female so that we could put it in any of these people. It's going to go inside something that we use in CAT scans and MRIs of whatever is their good arm to make a silicon rubber, then coated and painted in 3D, exact mirror image of their other limb. So you won't see all the really cool stuff that's in this series elastic set of 14 actuators, each one which has its own capability to sense temperature pressure. It also has a pneumatic cuff that holds it on, so the more they put themselves under load, the more it attaches. They take the load off and it becomes, again, compliant. I'm going to show you a guy doing a couple of simple things with this that we demonstrated in Washington. Can we look at this thing? Watch the fingers grab, the thumb comes up, wrist. This weighs 6.9 pounds. He's gonna scratch his nose. He's got 14 active degrees of freedom. Now he's gonna pick up a pen with his opposed thumb and index finger. Now he's gonna put that down, pick up a piece of paper, rotate all the degrees of freedom in his hand and wrist, and read it.
对于工程不是那么理解的人，也许觉得这是一个很简单的事情。可是要达成像手这样子的一个动作，其实它是很困难的。我有一次跟一位曾经学医的一位朋友在聊天，他说我们能够把一个东西看到了，然后我们准准的去拿起来，这是一个多么不容易的动作，因为这里头呢是你的大脑跟你的手的指挥系统跟你的手的所有的动作需要配合好。如果它没有配合好的时候，你眼睛看到那个东西，然后我去拿的时候呢，我会这样，我为什么没有拿到，或者是我这样子拿到了以后我拿起来太用力，这些都会出问题。它本来就是一个非常非常复杂的一个逻辑跟感知跟运动之间的过程。我曾经去访问过一位当时将近100岁的老和尚，我们在拍纪录片。那么他说他有一次中风，那他不知道，他说他在看报纸，他并不知道他已经中风。他那天早上在看报纸的时候，他去想要拿水喝，他就把杯子拿起来想要拿到嘴巴上，结果他发现他怎么把杯子要喝的地方他怎么跑到哪里去，他想放到嘴巴他怎么这样，他就觉得奇怪，他说为什么我今天不能控制，我其实他已经中风了。所以我要跟各位说的，他刚刚为什么当我们在电视上面看到很多可以做很多机器人做各种奇奇怪怪的动作，觉得那个很像很容易，那个是想象，真正你要做出来让像他刚刚那样子的一种东西是很不容易。可是他为什么要去挑战这个事情呢？他为什么要去挑战这个不可能呢？是因为在他的内心里面他有一个 why， 为什么？因为他觉得那些为了美国跑去打仗而牺牲了自己的身体的人需要有人替他们做一些事情。他不是想要发明一个义肢，而是他想要解决那些人的问题。那个 why 就是能够让他去 挑战那个不可能。所以这个影片虽然很短，可是我想我们都会感受到他那种挑战不可能的一个概念。